joy. We read the sounding joy.
This is time of joy, this time where we remember what Christ is doing in our midst. We remember what he has come to do, and we celebrate that together, don't we, church? Amen. He is good. I want you to find someone this morning. Greet them in the love of the Lord by the admonition of the Apostle Paul. Do not greet them with a holy kiss, but do anything else, and you should be okay. So, yeah, find someone. Say hello.
Well, good morning. We're glad that you've come to join us this morning at Louisville Grace Community Church of the Nazarene. We've got a a good group in here today. You may also be joining us online at lgcnaz.com or on our Facebook page. However you have joined us this morning, it is a joy to worship together with you. And we look forward to what the Lord is going to do in our midst today. We have a lot of announcements. That's not unusual. There's a lot of stuff going on around the church. The first one, of course, you probably heard throughout this week, probably saw on the news, that there was a huge tornado that ripped through the state. In particular, the town of Mayfield got hit very, very hard. We have a Church of the Nazarene there in Mayfield. That is still reeling from it, but also wanting to be part of the effort. And so here is how you can help. Now, we are partnering with Kingdom Overflow Ministry. Of course, you know Bob McCabe. He's going to be active in that as well. But we need help in collecting tarps and water to send down in order for relief. There are a lot of people were asking about crisis care kits. We actually have so many of the crisis care kits that we assembled available that we do not need extras at this time. But we are collecting tarps and collecting water. If you want to bring them at any point this week to the church, we will make sure it gets to the people it needs to get to. I'll probably get Bob to come and figure out how all of that's done. But we want to partner and we want to give immediate relief in any way that we can. So if you can collect those things and give them to the church at some point this week, we will get it down to Mayfield. So that way folks have the very basic necessities that they need in order to get things done. Normally we have prayer meeting on Sunday nights. Unfortunately, we will not be having this evening. I'll be down in E-Town conducting a little bit of district business. So if you show up, hey, you know what? If you want to show up and pray anyway without me, that is 100% okay. In fact, I encourage that, but it will not be led by me. So come and pray anyway. How about that? Board, just really quickly, I want to remind you of our Christmas gathering tomorrow at 6:30. If you are on the board, you know the details. Just wanted to remind you that that's coming. Also, boy, we got a lot of things going on. This Wednesday, we're not having our normal Bible study because our kids are going to be putting on the show of a lifetime. You're not going to want to miss it. It is dinner theater, which means you come in, you get a show, you get some music before and afterward. Our kids are going to do their very best in putting on this wonderful show for you, and you're going to get fed. Donations are welcome, not required, but we certainly would love whatever support you can give to our kids. That is this Wednesday at 6:30. Hope we can see you there. Boy, more Christmas stuff. We are caroling in the neighborhood just out back of the church, and we hope that you can join us for that. We had a small but mighty crew last time that went through, and I'm telling you, the impact it made on just the houses we were able to get to before it started pouring rain was amazing. There were people that were very, very touched that anyone would care to spread the joy of Christmas to them in their homes. People that said they hadn't seen people caroling in 40 years. It was wonderful. It really was. So if you can join us at 5:30 on December 21st, it's going to be a great time. Hope you can carol with us. Speaking of carols, we're going to be doing some more carols on December 24th. That is Christmas Eve for all of you who are taking notice there. Our Christmas Eve service, our candles and carol service, will be at 3 o'clock on Christmas Eve. Why 3 o'clock? Because a lot of people have family gatherings on Christmas Eve. We want you to be able to come and worship and enjoy in the season without having to choose between family dinner and church. We're going to make it easy for you. 3 o'clock candles and carols. It is a wonderful musical retelling of the Christmas story. I hope that you can be a part of that as well. Boy, I want to tell you, last week we took our faith promise pledges, and we had a goal over 16 months. I'm sorry, over 18 months. No, it was 16 months. I'm sorry. A goal of 16 months to hit pledges in the range of $16,000. I'm here to tell you that your pledges from last week, when totaled up throughout the week, equaled $18,965. Yeah. So we are confident that the goal and then some is going to be reached, and there are going to be people whose lives are changed because the funding is available to send, to equip, and to reach people that need to know Jesus, and we're excited about that. So thank you for your generosity, and we're going to keep you updated as to what those funds are going to month by month, so that way you know that it's for a good cause. Last but not least, you have seen the Christmas card display outside. If you're not familiar with this ministry, instead of mailing out Christmas cards to people that are in this church, you can just bring your Christmas cards here. You can place them in the box in the foyer under the name of whoever you want them to go to. You pay about half of the postage. And that money goes to benefit our ladies' ministry. Well, our ladies have determined what they want to do with that money. Perhaps several. I want to make sure he's not in here right now. Good. You probably know the fight that Stella Fitzwater has gone through with her cancer battle, and the difficulty that's put on the Fitzwaters. We would like every bit of that funding, and in fact, what was left over from the year before, to go to the Fitzwaters, because, man, we want to show them the love of Jesus in this church. And so if you want to send any cards out to anyone that you know in this church, we can just hand them to them, and we take your donations in order to make that happen. I think we're asking 25 cents per card, basically. So it's about 30. Oh my goodness, 30 cents. Okay, so it's not quite the bargain I thought it was, but just know that it goes to an incredible cause. So yeah, bring your Christmas cards and let us bless that family. I think they need some encouragement in this season, and we want to make sure that they know that the Spirit is alive and well here at Grace. Boy, we've got a lot to be thankful for, even in a tough time in our world. We've got a lot to be thankful for, and we're here in this season of joy, and over the last couple of weeks, we have already lit the candle of hope. It's starting to get really short. We lit the candle of peace, signifying the peace that Jesus brings into our world, and so we know that the Advent season brings all of these things to mind. Hope, peace, joy, and love are what are given to us in the promise of the coming of Jesus our Lord. This week, we light our third candle, the candle of joy, to remind us that the arrival of Christ brought joy to us that could only be adequately expressed in the full praises of the heavenly host. The third candle is rose-colored to remind us that the joy of the Lord blooms wherever He has planted in our lives. We understand that our happiness comes and goes with the ebbs and flows of our lives. We can't always be on a high. We can't always be just exuberant in our lives, but there's joy that undergirds everything that we do. There is a hope and a peace and a love that abides and fulfills itself in joy. See, the joy of the Lord remains firm and steady in our hearts. We both receive Him with gladness and remain in Him. From the 15th chapter of the Gospel of John, Jesus shares this for those who choose to find themselves and remain in Him. He says, I have loved you. He says, I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in His love. I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. So as we light the candle of joy this morning, may the season be one in which the joy of the Lord surrounds you, your loved ones, everyone that you meet. Seek Him earnestly, remain in Him, and you will have joy that overflows. Let's pray together. Jesus, may we seek You, and may we find You in this season. As we wait on You, may we remain in Your love and feel that joy that comes from knowing the One who has promised to us. And may it continue to grow as we anticipate You coming again. Our hope is in You. For it is in the wonderful name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Church, would you stand as we continue to give Him praise? Day.
stars began. Father, love is reigning o'er us. Brother, love binds man to man. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph song of life. Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till He appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks the new and glorious morn.
Church, you can be seated for a moment. We're going to prepare ourselves now for a time of giving of our tithes and offerings. I hope that... I know we've asked a lot for funding for different things throughout the last few weeks. I want us to know that the kingdom of God doesn't require a cent in order to move. However, he does require those who are yielded to his will. Here in the time where we give tithes and offerings in the church, it is an expression of surrender to the Lord who has provided us with so much. It is an act of worship and saying, God, I understand that you have blessed me with everything that I have in my life, and so I give this back in obedience. And so here in this time when we give, may we do so simply because we worship, simply because we love, simply because we adore. Not out of obligation, not out of any other reason, but just loving the King. And so I ask, church, that you would pray with me for the giving of our tithes and offerings this morning. Lord, we love you. We submit to you. We praise you and adore you. We worship you in this. God, I ask that you would take what we give. And Lord, that it wouldn't just benefit your church, little c, but Lord, that it would be taken into the kingdom. Lord, that people's lives would be changed. So bless it, both the gift and the giver and the recipient of whatever comes on the other end of this offering, Lord. We love you, for it is in your name we pray. Amen.
Of the Lord sing praise.
and we won't be quiet. Oh, we'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. Oh, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There is joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. Oh, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. There is joy in this house today. Oh, we shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. There is joy in this house today.
Amen. Yeah, go ahead. There is joy. And I'm so grateful for a king who can bring that even in, again, difficulty. And so we give him praise today. And you know what, kids? It's time for a little bit of joy for you too. So I'm going to ask that you will stand up, that you will go find Pastor Allie in the back. Okay, there's the joy right there. Leave it to our kids to do what I've been waiting for you guys to do all morning. Woo!
I'm happy, encouraged to see our kids that love going down and learning about Jesus so much. That it means so much to them, and that they do. They find joy in this season, and it's so easy for a kid to find joy because life is still so new and still so fresh, and there's just so many things to be excited about, and I love it. And there's something about the joy, especially together, being together, celebrating and singing and thinking about all the things about Christmas that's upcoming that just sort of fill our heart, and then there is this wonderful spirit among the church. However, I also know that what we hope, what we can bring home to wherever we go or wherever we dwell, is that there is sort of this interpersonal joy that begins to dwell up in this season. And that, however, is much, much harder. It's a little tougher to maintain a spirit or a feeling of joy when we feel so isolated, or when we feel so attacked, or we just feel like everything around us just isn't the way it needs to be. We're going to talk about that here in just a minute as we prepare to go into our message for today. We're in a series called Dear Theo, and if you're not acquainted with this series yet, you're probably thinking that's a very strange title for anything that you would preach in the church. We're going through the entire Gospel of Luke. We're going through the book of Acts continuously. And those two books were written by Luke to Theophilus. And so writing this letter to Theo is really telling the whole story of Christ from his promise to his birth, to his ministry, to his death and resurrection, all the way through the birth of the church. And we're in Luke chapter 18 now. We're not going to go into that quite yet. But I still think about this idea of a personal faith, a personal joy, what it means to these kinds of things. Some things are at their best when they're personal, right? Some things are absolute tops when they're personal. I think about, if you're a regular in the workforce, having a personal day, boy, that's good, isn't it? Personal days are great. Personal hygiene. I don't know about y'all, but I am grateful for personal hygiene. I hope it's corporate hygiene, to be honest. Personal hygiene is great. Personal pizza. Yeah. See it up there? You can make any pizza personal. Yes. With applause from the youth, absolutely. Personal pizza is great. What about this one? You probably heard this a lot in the church. personal relationship with Jesus Christ. If you have been in the church or around the church, or you've heard anyone on television talk about the church, this is kind of one of those key buzz phrases that continues to be said over and over about what it means to be a follower of Christ. I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Like, how many times have you heard that? If you've heard that at least 1,000 times, raise your hand. Yeah. Okay, good. I hope that continues on, because there is something wonderful about having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. The exact phrase I've heard from preachers, from youth leaders, from evangelists, written on tracts that are handed out to people, which I have my own personal opinions on, but let's not worry about that. I would hear testimonies from people. Man, I've got this personal relationship. They say, life was difficult until I accepted Jesus as my personal Savior. What a wonderful testimony. I looked up the definition of personal, not because I didn't know what it was, but I feel like the dictionary kind of gives us a better articulation of what the word personal means. And what personal means is of, affecting, or belonging to a particular person rather than to anyone else. Personal is mine. The idea of a personal relationship even reflects on how we've crafted our worship music over the years. Again, if you have been in the church for the last 5-10 years, you've probably heard songs like this. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I sing your praise. Yeah, all of that. I love this one. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Yeah. Hey, listen, nothing wrong with those songs. Jesus is thinking about you. He does love you. He did die for you. He does want a personal relationship with you. All of these things. But now some of you probably already see where I'm going with this, though, right? For something so deeply personal, sometimes we have this tendency to hold on to it to ourselves, to make it a little more about what my faith is and not really let it touch the others around us. You probably got a sense that that is where this was going in this. And you may be already thinking some things in counter to what I'm about to say. Well, didn't Jesus tell us to pray in private? I think in Matthew chapter 6, I don't have the scripture up, but I think about in Matthew chapter 6, you know, Jesus is beginning to get on those people who are praying publicly in the streets, right? And they're just praying so that other people will hear him. And his prescription is, well, then go into your little private place. Go into your closet, right? And go and pray. And there is where the Father will see you and reward you instead of doing all this stuff out and in the open. You may even say, but didn't Jesus, when he wanted to go pray and express his faith, didn't he go out into the private places trying to get away from people so that way he could express his spirituality and all of these other kinds of things? Didn't he go alone to spend time with his Father? Well, yeah, he did that. Doesn't mean that there is not a personal element to our faith. It doesn't mean that it is something that isn't deeply, personally impactful in our lives. But as we begin to look into Luke chapter 18 here in just a moment, I want us to be aware of something about how our faith is so much more than personal. It means so much more than personal. There are some things that personal simply cannot mean when it comes to our relationship with Christ. Let's get into the scripture this morning. If you have your Bibles with you, I'll ask that you would turn to Luke chapter 18, and we're going to read verses 9 through 14. I read through it from the New International Version when I preach. You may have a different version, or you may have an electronic version like I'm using this morning. Either way, if you'd like, you can turn to the New International. Otherwise, you can look right up here on the screen. So this is Luke chapter 18, verses 9 through 14. Now, To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. He said, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. Now the Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, God, I thank you that I am not like other people. Robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, and I give a tenth of all that I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He wouldn't even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. I tell you that this man, the tax collector, this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for what you are revealing to us through your word. I pray that, God, as we read this, we believe as the church that your Spirit inspired the writing of these. And Lord, I would believe that your Holy Spirit is here now interpreting for us, that you are speaking to us through the word as we delve into it together. God, would you give us clear hearts and clear minds and open minds and hearts as well, Lord. For we know that your word is powerful. Would you speak to us powerfully today, I pray. In the name of Jesus. Amen. So I want to begin because as we look through this portion of the scripture, I believe that you automatically see from Jesus, he's talking about an attitude of one person versus the other. And it is this attitude that says to us that true faith lived out is not self-invested. See, Jesus, this is the interesting thing. I mean, Jesus is really tough on these Pharisees. Throughout the entire scripture, you see Jesus sort of butting heads with these Pharisees over and over and over again. And if you're not familiar with the Pharisees, just real quick to sort of give you an idea of who the Pharisees were, they were a group that over the course of several hundred years before this had developed out of a desperate need for the people of God to return to the scriptures. If you know the history of Israel, man, when they were following God, when they were following his plans, when they were reading through the scripture, when they were following the commandments that were given to them about loving God and loving everyone else the way that that was supposed to be done, man, the nation prospered. And when they forgot about God and started treating everyone else around them with the same kind of violence and contempt that all the other countries around them had been treating everyone with, man, the blessing, it went away. When they were loving God again, they were on a high. And then when they forgot and decided to give in to their own desires and just live for themselves, man, they were on a low again until eventually they got so low they could never recover. In fact, another empire came in and conquered first Israel and then Judah. So they were a people that were captive. And the people from there decided to say, you know what, we're not going to ever let this happen again. We don't ever want to see that we have strayed away so far from the Word of God that we're not even a people anymore. And so from out of that need rose these people, these Pharisees, who said, no matter what, it doesn't matter what it takes, we're going to follow every letter of this law until we die. We want to make sure that this law lives in us. And so, man, they rose out of this need to be a people who were locked into the Scriptures and followed it to the very nth of their ability, especially since worship at the temple was difficult or impossible. Man, the Pharisees, for a while, they were teachers, they were rabbis, they were the ones who really began to draw the people back into a love of the scriptures. They were very concerned with proper interpretation of the scriptures, which, by the way, their scriptures were basically our Old Testament. They were the ones who studied, they were the ones who debated scripture, and adherence to the law became very central to their identity. Pharisees, if they were here today, if they existed in our current setting right here, they would be great at things like Bible study and Bible quizzing. I'm not calling you teens Pharisees. Don't worry about that. But y'all are very dedicated to the Word. It's an admirable thing. They knew the law. They practiced it very, very well. And in verse 12, if you look at verse 12 of the scripture, man, this guy is telling the Lord about how great he is and about how well he follows the law. He says, I give a tenth of everything that comes in and of all my spices. And Lord, look at how well I follow you. That's not such a bad thing, right? It's not. But obedience simply to following the rules, making sure that you don't fall out of line with what is written, is not really what moves or impresses the heart of God. See, there are those that over the history of their lives in the church, maybe they say, you know what, I have been in this church for 50 years and I have not missed a single Sunday of that entire time since the church has been open. I've been here every time the doors have been open. I've had perfect attendance for 50 years. There will be people that will participate in every study every time that the doors are open here. There are people that will know the scriptures, that will have the words of the scriptures memorized in their head, inside and out. They could quote the gospels backward and forward from memory, and they still, maybe, quite possibly, will not actually know Jesus. There are people that will follow every direction to the very letter of what it's supposed to do, but still not really know why or have any reason why other than accomplishment or hoping to escape some sort of punishment in the life after. See, Jesus invested in personal study of the scriptures, but that isn't what made him holy. There's something far beyond that. Knowledge is a means. Attendance and personal Bible study is a means to something greater. In fact, John Wesley called things like worship and Bible study and prayer and fasting and all of these other activities that Christians engage in as means of grace. They are not the grace into themselves, but they are things that we do that enable us to have this communication opened with the Father. So many of us, we go to the things that begin to open the lines of communication and forget to talk. Forget to actually have this time with the Father. See, there's nothing wrong with investing in ourselves. There's nothing wrong with becoming more knowledgeable. There's nothing wrong with study and prayer and adherence to the commandments. All of these things are wonderful, good things. But when you sing, when you pray, when you study scripture, when you go to church, is that your goal for the week? Is that what you're looking forward to? Or is it the means to have a greater relationship with the Father? This is what I'm afraid of. Some of us go to church just because church is what we do. Do we come into these doors and expect something incredible from the Lord Himself? Do we expect to actually worship Him? Or do we expect to just sort of have this little club of friends that we like to be close to? Do we like the social experience of it? Do we like that people are doing things the right way and we just enjoy the neat and tidy lifestyle? Do we like all that kind of stuff? Or are we desperate for something greater within these habits that we have formed as the people of God? There's nothing wrong with investing in these things, but they do not constitute within themselves a relationship with God. See, true personal faith, it is not merely self-invested, but true personal faith also isn't isolated. We are not living out our faith on some island somewhere that is separate from impact on the world around us, on people around us. Our faith is not just me and the Father. Our faith is extremely, extremely outwardly focused when it is done the right way. It's not lived in a vacuum. See, this was the Pharisees' biggest mistake. Well, I mean, there are several big mistakes, but honestly, this is the attitude that he took into this conversation with God was his biggest mistake. He made the mistake that his qualifications mattered more to his God than anything else. In You know, we think, well, Christ died to take away my sin, right? He gave his life on a cross. He shed his blood for me so that when I mess up, that I can ask him for forgiveness because Jesus already spilled his blood on my behalf. That whole idea, he died to take away my sin, so I want to stay away from sin, and so my focus becomes to make sure that I'm not letting sin creep into this vertical relationship between me and the Father, this up and down kind of mentality. And I don't know about you, but I think especially in the early times of my faith, that there was a time where I came to what I believe was a saving faith in God, but it was still very young, it was still very naive, and I honestly pictured God as this cosmic force in the sky that every time I messed up, he was at the chalkboard going, strike against you. Keeping score. Uh-oh, I said this word I shouldn't have to. Whoop, there's another strike. Psh. Well, I got to go do some good deeds. Psh, psh. Okay, now they evened out. Too bad, too good. Am I going to get to heaven? And I honestly, these were worries that I had. I don't know if that was your experience when you first got to a saving knowledge of God, as if there was some sort of tally at the end of this life where things were just going to even out and hopefully I'd done more good than bad. And honestly, it scared me. I was obsessed with this idea. I was obsessed with the idea that I might sin against God and not even know it. And then I wouldn't have the chance to repent because God knew it, but I didn't know it. And, all this kind of stuff, man, I would mess everything up. I was afraid that I would just get God mad all the time. So ideally, the way that I lived my faith was just to keep my head down, go to church, have my own little personal faith here, pray for any forgiveness I needed, and work on just keeping my nose clean. How many of us are still in that kind of faith? Just hoping to not ruffle any feathers so that we can just sort of shuffle through this life and hope that at the end we've managed to stay clean enough for God to allow us entry into eternity. You know what the problem with life is? It isn't clean. It isn't neat and tidy. It's messy. Man, the church is no exception. The church is messy. It's full of messy people. Messy problems. Sometimes relationships in the church can be messy. Even between people that should love each other and do love each other, man, it can be hard. The world we live in is definitely messy. As you grow in faith, sometimes when we keep that mentality and we just sort of chug along in our faith and we think we've arrived at a certain point of spirituality, you know, me and the Father, we're just walking side by side, just me and this little personal relationship with God, you may start to become a little bit bothered by those in the church that haven't progressed to your level of spirituality. Say, man, I've been walking with God for 20 years, but this guy who just came in the church, man, he says he loves Jesus, but that language hasn't changed yet. That attitude hasn't changed yet. That habit hasn't changed yet. We begin to go, oof, well, I don't need to be around that, because guess what? That's going to start to infringe on my personal purity. I got to get away from that guy. He doesn't need to be around me because, man, I got to keep this thing between me and him clean, right? See, that was what happened with this Pharisee. Going back into the text, this is what happened with this Pharisee. He lived a faith that was so private between him and his Father that this other man who was genuinely, desperately longing to connect with the God who wanted to give him grace and mercy and wanted to fill his life, he said, ugh, what is he doing here? Oh, God, help us if we ever have that kind of mentality when someone who is broken comes into our midst, especially in the time that we worship. But see, the relationship only went one way for the Pharisee. His prayer about the sinner in his presence didn't even matter. He didn't even give a thought to what that tax collector may think in his midst. By the way, you got to know, a tax collector is not someone that was looked upon very favorably in Jewish society. I mean, if you really look at the role of the tax collector, they were people, the Empire of Rome had taken over so many different people groups and different, I guess you could call them countries or whatever you want to call them, territories. And Rome had conquered Judah, had conquered basically all the territories that they were a part of. And so the Jews in this time, they were living in a time of occupation, and in order for them to continue to be in Rome's good graces, just for letting them live and express their own religion, they had to pay taxes to Caesar. But Rome didn't want to send their own people out to collect taxes from the Jews, and so what they did was they recruited Jews from within the system to go and essentially be traitors to their own people, to say, here, I'm taking money from you, brother, to give to this empire that you never wanted to take over in the first place. They were reviled. And the worst part about tax collectors is they had a reputation, because, man, they didn't make much anyway. If you were an occupied people, the tax collectors would take a little bit for Caesar and take just a little bit extra for themselves. Man, they did not like tax collectors. They were the scum of the earth to the Jewish people. So this Pharisee is praying, and he's got this nice little connection with God going on, and he sees someone and he reviles, and someone who is dirty and impure to him, and he begins to pray to God, thankfully I'm not him. You know, there was one time that I went to an event, and it was at a really large church. And I remember even just pulling into that parking lot on that Sunday morning, how difficult it was to find a parking spot. And I remember, this is how you can go to like a church, and all this kind of stuff is happening, and people are like cutting one another off for parking spots because we're all in competition with one another, because we're there to live out our own personal faith. It doesn't matter if your brother or sister is pulling in, and it doesn't matter if you hurt them, because you're going to take care of your relationship with God. Everyone else is just kind of doing their own relationship thing too. I heard a story. There was a pastor that I had mentored under for a while, and he actually said that his mentor told him a story about driving to church one morning. Did I ever tell you traffic bothers me? This is why these stories like resonate with me. I feel like I'm a holy person until I have to drive with other people on the road. He was telling a story about his mentor who wanted to remind him about how outward our faith should always be. And he was driving to church one morning, and so he was running down the road, and then someone cut him off in traffic. And I mean, it was bad, almost took off his front bumper. And so this pastor sped up and got in the car, and he got right up beside the car that had just cut him off, and he looked over and began to shake his fist and had these bulging eyes and started to yell at him, and then he looked at it and he said, oh, that's Brother Murphy. You know, they're going to the same church together. One wasn't mindful of the other on the road. The other was ready to bite his head off, and both of them weren't able to give grace to the other. And he said, man, it really made me think about how I'm living my faith. Is it a personal faith, or is it one that gives grace to other people even when they step on our toes? See, we got to realize that in the midst of living out what we believe, that we're not just single units on an island seeking connection with God, but we live as ambassadors. We are for some people the only example of Christ they will ever see. That Pharisee was not concerned with that tax collector in the least, though he was on his knees seeking repentance, seeking for God to give him mercy, because it didn't matter. As long as I'm clean, that's all that matters. So we all started somewhere. Some of us may still be on that journey this morning, trying to even discover if we even believe about this Jesus. Some of us in here, though, we believe that we have had an encounter with Christ. We believe that He has saved us and He's brought us into something that is much more meaningful than ourselves and much greater than our own individual faith. And it all started somewhere, right? And it likely started because someone else's faith is what led us there. Because real faith is not self-invested. Real faith is not isolated from those around us. A real, true faith is humble to the very end, knowing that I've never had all of my ducks in a row. When faith becomes too personal, too much about how spiritual I am, others who don't know the one that I have faith in, they become obstacles rather than heart and flesh and bone. Or even worse, those other people that aren't like me become the enemy. When I get too wrapped in my holiness, my spirituality, my relationship, other people, they just become like cones on the road, right? We're just swerving around them or we're knocking them over in pursuit of the stuff that we want. The Pharisee in verse 11 made a public display of the tax collector's sin in order to make himself look more spiritual. A living, breathing child of God. Oh God, help us. Can we go back to verse 14 for a moment? Can you bring that up on the screen? Jesus says, I tell you, this man, talking about the tax collector, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. The one who openly admitted his sin, his fault, his failure, his shortcoming before God, who sought his mercy, was the one that got justification before God. The one who left that place in God's favor. Go figure. The one following the law as it was written in the book was the one who still found himself out of favor with God when all was said and done, because he worshiped the book more than he worshiped its author. I think about the state of our world, and it feels like we've been locked in this state of just discontentment and honestly this adversarial kind of feeling between people for 5-6 years now. It just seems like it never ends. I mean, there's always been political parties that don't like each other and are always challenging each other. It feels like that has become more of less of an ideological disagreement and more of a just, if you like this color or you like this color, you're my enemy. And the worst part is every one of them is convinced that they're the ones who are right and that those who are wrong are to be eliminated. In this world today, nobody gives an inch. Nobody is willing to talk. None of these groups that are in this battle between one another can get together without some sort of intense anger or intense emotion boiling over. We can't have political disagreements anymore, because what it ends up being is one side shouting on one side of the sidewalk and one side shouting at the others on the other side of the sidewalk, and there's no humility because we think that we are so right, that those people are so vile. We've got to get it together and understand that the only reason we have any worth, any value, any grace, anything, is because God has given it to us. We've got to get this in our hearts. Man, it continues to erupt into senseless acts of violence. All because all these people care about, and all we, when we are so wrapped up in our own righteousness, our own virtue, when we think that we are the only person that could be right, can only end wrong. As the church, I mean, we believe that Jesus is the answer to this. Yeah, he is. I hope that when we know this, that we don't live out that knowledge with a heart of superiority. If we truly believe that He has saved us and that we are cleansed and that we are healed and we believe it's the right way to live and it's the best way, that we're going out and we're shouting people down in the streets, Jesus is the best way! You dirty, rotten sinner overdoing whatever it is. I can't believe you're not in church. How dare you? That will never, ever win the day. If we approach those outside of the church with the same kind of smug attitude as the Pharisee, we are part of the issue. So no matter your affiliation with any party, believe it or not, they've been wrong before and so have you. And instead of an attitude that says, thank you that I'm not like those idiots, how about, thank you, God, that you love me despite my shortcomings. Help me share the truth of who you are with others that may not see things the way that I do. Personal faith is not factional. Personal faith is not isolated. It is not self-seeking. Personal faith is humbly seeking to know and do the will of our Savior. And I'm thankful for this morning. In just a few moments, we're going to prepare as a church to receive the elements of communion. We have symbols of His shed blood and His broken body. Bread and juice, to remind us that there is one who is more holy than all. There is one who deserved for the entire world to bow before Him and give Him praise. And yet, for the sake of the world and others around Him that He loved, instead He chose to die on a criminal's cross. We believe that as we take the elements of communion together, that we are remembering, first of all, His sacrifice. And we delight in the fact that because He died, that we might have life. That once we were broken and lost in our own sin and there was no redemption, there was no hope, and then He came and He said, you know what, I know that you have been a sinner, and I know that you have you've basically forfeit your life as a penalty for that. He said, you've chosen your own life, your own world over what God has set up for you. You've rejected that with the way that you've lived, but I'm telling you what, I'm going to send you my Son. Because I don't want that for you. I want to give you another chance. I want to give you another opportunity. I want you to live this life, and I want you to be holy, and I want you to be freed, and I want you to know that I love you with all of my heart, and I would give you anything. I would give you all of myself so that you could be freed. That's what this means. But it also means this: we follow His example. And the one who deserved every accolade, but instead chose to humble Himself on a cross. So we, who are the people that I hope are living lives that are holy and pure and blessed by the Father, would give anything to see others know it too. So in a moment, we're going to take these elements together, and I want to let you know, if you want to make that declaration that your faith is in Him, you don't have to be a member of this church. You don't have to be a member of a church anywhere. You don't have to have ever, at any point, prior to this, made a declaration of faith. You can do that right now, in this place. This table, these elements are open to anyone who expresses their faith in Jesus Christ, and there is no blocking you. No one's going to turn you away. This is an opportunity for us to declare our faith and to renew our covenant with our Lord. And so in just a moment, I'll have you line up and we'll have the elements prepared for you. I'd ask that you would hold on to them until we take them together when everyone has received the elements. But let us remember today what Jesus has done for us, and may we live with the same mindset that gives our all for Him. Church, would you pray with me? Father, I thank you for the example that you've set. And I thank you that you did. You died for us so that we might live. God, in these moments, may we renew our covenant with you. Or may we seal our covenant with you in the taking of these elements. For we are your people, and we love you. It's in your wonderful and holy name we pray. Amen. As you feel led, would you make a line and come forward as we prepare to receive these elements together? blood and the body are a symbol of the covenant that Jesus began with his disciples on the night that he shared his last meal with them as he was preparing to be arrested, put on trial, and eventually crucified. On that night when they were eating together, he took the bread and he broke it. He said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you." On the same night, shortly after, he took the cup and he raised it and said, "This is the blood of my new covenant, which is poured out for you. Take and drink this in remembrance of me." Jesus, we praise you for hope. We praise you for you are the one who can manifest peace in our lives. Lord, we praise you because you bring incredible joy. We thank you that you are the author of love. God, I pray that as we renew our covenant with you today, that such wonderful gifts would never go to our heads. And Lord, that we wouldn't hoard up its treasures to ourselves. But just like you did, Jesus, you would come down out of a high place, shed your blood and have your body broken for those who didn't deserve it. May we too, Lord, who have been given a wonderful gift, a wonderful future, Lord, that have been given joy in the midst of tumultuous times, Lord, not hoard it either, but instead pour it out to those, Lord, that maybe we don't think deserve it. But you love them anyway, and so we do. Oh God, may we live that way in everything that we do. For it is in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Church, continue to live that example. Continue to be blessed by his presence. Continue to be enveloped in his peace. Now go and live out his love in the world around you. Church, you're dismissed. Have a great Sunday.